each and every one. Hey, I've got some news. Don't get too excited when I tell you.
You're gonna be grandpa again.
No, there's gonna be a total eclipse tomorrow.
I hadn't heard about that.
I couldn't wait to get here to tell you that. Yes, total eclipse of the sun. And don't look at her, you go blind. Make sure you got the right glasses.
About welding hood.
Welding hood, that will work.
What's gonna be funny is if it doesn't happen. I didn't think about that till last night. Our park ranger said, he said, "Have you thought about this? What if it doesn't come?" And I'm like, you know, I never thought of that, but it may not. He said, "All these scientists have all these calculations, but really, are they 100% sure it's coming?" I'm like, I don't know. They think they are, but...
There you have it.
You never know.
It might not come.
It may not come.
Or maybe cloud.
It'll be funny if it doesn't, not funny at all.
Maybe cloud, I can hear that. I couldn't figure out, you know, this was supposed to be back to school emphasis today, and I was trying to figure, should I preach a funeral message for the death of summer? Maybe a resurrection for the...
But it's just not...
Parents, resurrection of school. Summer has died and school has began. Parents are excited. I don't think the children are quite excited as parents. Now, kids seem to like school more than what I like school. I didn't want to go back to school when the summer was over. I enjoyed running through the bottoms and swinging through the trees on grapevines. I tell stories like that and people really don't believe I'm telling the truth. When I was a kid, we played hard from daylight to dark. We weren't at home. And Mom would holler, "Gert! Gert, come eat!" Late evening was the only time I thought about eating. If you didn't have breakfast, it might be dark before you ate again. So we were active kids. I don't see active kids. You know, they talk about that there's a problem with kids being a little obese. And I listen to that and I think, well, you know, we should get off the couch as kids, especially. But some things are just natural. But here they go back to school to learn. So I decided to talk about rest today because I think parents might get a little rest. Hanging with their children. But school's back, you know, it's back in session, and time to dig out the rake, you know, because the leaves are going to be falling pretty quick. It's getting close to the fall, and golly, winter's coming. That depression. I love the change of the seasons, I do. I like to see the seasons change. I'm ready for summer to be over and fall to come. Have a birthday next month, September. Always liked the month of September, maybe just because my birthday is in September, but it's always a good time of the year for me. But this morning, Matthew chapter 11, verse 28. Matthew chapter 11, verse 28. And Jesus is offering us an invitation to rest. This is from the Lord Jesus Christ, offering us an invitation to rest. Matthew chapter 11, verse 28 says, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light." You know, sometimes we use the phrase, I've used this phrase, and others heard other people use this phrase, and said, "Man, I am at the end of my rope." You ever been at the end of your rope? Meaning you are totally stressed out to a point that You just, I can't take anymore. I've had it. And looking forward to Labor Day weekend, 3-day weekend. The world gives us holidays and long weekends, and we can have barbecues, and we can go on vacations, take road trips, and these things are great and wonderful and fine, and they give us a physical relaxation when we get involved in them. But there's a greater rest. I don't know that you've noticed. There's a greater rest that we need, and people are really in need of a greater rest. The world is really in turmoil right now. People are, man, at the end of the ropes. Everywhere you see people that are just totally stressed out. So this rest that is so needful is something that can only come through knowing God's Son, Jesus Christ. And this is what Jesus is saying here when he says, come to me. He says, come unto me, and ye that labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. So I'm thinking this morning about this, and I'm thinking of the rest of salvation, of eternal life. Listen to the invitation that Jesus gives. Come unto me. He didn't say, come to church. He didn't say, come to some religion. He says not to come to anything or anyone other than himself, Jesus. Now, this may seem a little basic to us as we think about it as Christians and thus we go to church. But it's really, when you think about it, when you just sit and think about it, it's profound. What Jesus has said. And the world would be perplexed. And the world doesn't like it, but there's only one way of salvation and eternal life. In Acts, Paul, it says, there neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. And in John, Jesus says unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father except by and through me. It's always been this way, that Jesus is the only way to obtain eternal life. The only way to have salvation, really the only hope of any future is found in Jesus Christ. You see, it's always been that way, and I believe that it will always be that way, that God has ordained and proclaimed from the foundation of the world that Jesus Christ, His Son, would be the way. He would be the truth, and He would be our life. You see, real eternal life and salvation is about a personal relationship with God. And we find that personal relationship with God through His Son, Jesus Christ. Anything else that we try to find hope in is not salvation, other than His Son. I wonder this morning, do people long for a rest of eternal life and salvation? They should come to Jesus. Listen to what he says. He says, all ye. I'm so thankful that God's invitation is extended to everyone, that no one is excluded from this invitation, and it goes to every human being, anywhere, any place, anytime, around the world. All. And you know, this becomes extremely important when we understand the scripture that says we have all sinned and we all come short of the glory of God because we all have a need of a Savior. Isaiah told us that we all, like sheep, have gone astray. every one of us, hey, we've all been there, as they say, and we've all done that. We are sinners by nature. And since everyone is in need, this invitation is extended to everyone. Revelation 22 and 17, and the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let him that heareth say, come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him come and drink of the water of life freely. Wow. The invitation goes to the uttermost parts of the earth. Not only to us, but to everyone, every human being, everywhere. I think that's why Jesus said, go into all the world and proclaim the gospel. He wanted everyone to receive this water of life that we can so freely drink of, that he had to provide. We can come and drink of it without price, without charge. It's free if you're thirsty. If you're thirsty and hungry for eternal life through Jesus Christ, if you're longing for rest for your spiritual soul, and this is what happens when we drink of this water of life. We will find rest. He says, I will give you rest. When I think of rest, I think of a quietness, a calmness, a refreshing. Some time back, I told my wife I had this wonderful, she got me a white t-shirt. I never wear a white t-shirt, but she got me this wonderful white t-shirt. This may sound silly, but boy, it was comfortable. And I wore it to sleep in. When I get home at night and I would take a bath, one of the most enjoyments that I had was putting on a white t-shirt. Because it was so comfortable, it was so relaxing, and it was so quiet that it was time to go to sleep. And every night when I was tired and I got home and I slipped into my white t-shirt, I just felt at peace. It's hard to explain. You know, man says that we have to work hard. So hold on, struggle, struggle, and strife. That's what the world is all about. But Jesus says to simply come unto him and he will give us rest. What a blessing this truth is, brothers and sisters. This truth reveals itself in several unique and special areas that we can find this rest. We are given peace with God. You know, I remember being in a struggle with God, being at war with God, being at enmity with God. But Paul says, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Man, don't the people of the world need to be at peace with God? We struggle against God's will, and we struggle with our will, like children fighting their parents, struggling to see who has the power and the control. The world is at enmity with God. The greatest warfare that's happening today is the world contending with God's will. People are not entering God's purpose. We are giving a calm assurance of our salvation in the drink of the water freely. Paul says the Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. All that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out, Jesus said. So we have this calm assurance of salvation. When we come to Jesus, he's going to give us eternal life. He's going to give us peace. No wonder Paul said that everything in life works to the good of people who love the Lord, to those that are called according to his purpose. You know, people struggle and they wonder, and this total eclipse of the sun has brought a lot of talk. And people are concerned about the future, and with the politics of the world, people are in a stir about the future. You know, we're always thinking about the future, but we can only live in the present, but we're always worried about tomorrow and the future. Jesus said, don't take no thought for tomorrow because you don't know what a day might bring. We have control over today, but we don't have control over tomorrow. And besides that, tomorrow, did you know it never comes? It's always today. But I find it calm assurance, even as I've grown old, assurance of the future. I feel at peace with God, and I feel like that I've been given a strength for the journey of life. Isaiah says, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not be faint. Man, that was a wonderful thought. I remember in the days of my childhood, that song being sung by a congregation that said, teach me, Lord, teach me, Lord, to wait. Teach me, Lord, to wait down on my knees. What assurance that we have that we can wait upon the Lord and His strength. Maybe someone thinks, well, golly, that's exactly what I need. What I've been looking for in life is assurance, a calm, a peace about the future, a rest. The world's in turmoil. But this peace and this rest can only come through God's Son, Jesus Christ. And the world rejects. They reject God and they reject His Son. See, there's this satisfaction, which is part of the rest, that when we enter into this peace with God, this eternal life, He says, take my yoke upon you and learn of me. For I am meek, lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is you see, there's a satisfaction that we find in serving the Lord. It's something that the world can't give us. At first thought, it really doesn't sound right. You know, it kind of doesn't make sense to our natural thinking. We think of taking up on a yoke as getting to work, not resting, you know, because they would put the yoke on the oxen. But Jesus didn't make a mistake when He said this to us. Our service with Christ should never be a burden. But rather, it is a blessing. You know, sometimes when I get to thinking that being a speaker of God's Word, a preacher, that, wow, what a burden. But then I realize what a great and wonderful gift and blessing it is that He's given me this ability to stand up and tell people about eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. And I'm overwhelmed by the blessing that I've been given. But sometimes, you know, we get to thinking that it's a burden. But Jesus said that taking up His yoke should be something that would be easy for us. The key word here is the yoke. This was a wooden device that it actually connected two oxen together so they could pull the load of the weight that they were dealing with. So this would normally mean that both oxen were pulling together equally. But Jesus says that His yoke is easy and His burden is light. Why? Because He has already done the work. As we yoke up with Him, He is there for our fellowship. See, this is the same promise that God made to the nation of Israel as they prepared to enter into the promised land. And listen, church, this is important. This should be important to us at this point in the history of our church and our Christian lives. All that they needed to do was simply be obedient to God. And God would take care of all of the obstacles that were in the way. I really believe that for you and I, all we need to do is simply be obedient. When we are, God will get the job done. You see, the rest of satisfaction is found in our service to the Lord. When we're doing God's will in life, we will have a satisfaction that we can't obtain anywhere else. It's a peace, it's a rest, it's a calm, it's a quietness. But the rest of satisfaction is found in surrender. You know, we know what surrender is. You know, I used to watch the Indians and the cowboys and the military shows and all of that. And we'd play and we'd have a white flag. And we'd raise that white flag and wave it. And maybe on the TV show, the opposing enemy would wave the flag or someone would wave the white flag. And that was a sign of surrender. See, listen to what he says. Come, take, and learn. I learned something at Lusterville School. This is back to school Sunday. All three of these words are verbs. Come, take. They are words which are anticipating some action on the part of the person that's hearing. Hey, come here. Hey, take this. Hey, learn. So, surrender means that we yield to the power and control our possession of someone else. You raise a white flag, you're saying, hey, I surrender. I'm yielding to your power, to your control, to your possession. So, for us as believers, when we surrender to Jesus Christ, that's what he's talking about. We are to surrender everything we have and every hope to be to the will of Jesus Christ, God's Son. We are to place ourselves at His disposal. We are to allow Him to be our absolute Lord and ruler of our lives. And when this happens, we will find a genuine satisfaction for our souls. No wonder there's so much struggle. No wonder there's so much unrest in life, because we as people are not surrendering to the Lord. Paul says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable, perfect will of God. Surrender your bodies. Surrender your life. In other words, to the Lord. So, he invites us to come unto him. He invites us to yoke up with him and walk with him. Life. I believe when we do that, that's the only way that we can really know true rest. The rest of salvation and the rest of being satisfied. I wonder this morning. Maybe you're weary, heavy laden in life. Do you long for a rest What about satisfaction? Are you satisfied? Are you finding any satisfaction? Then, we are to come to Jesus Christ, God's Son. Come unto me, all ye that labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. My, don't you wish the world could just hear that scripture? Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart. To learn about Jesus Christ, God's Son. And ye shall find rest unto your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. I wonder how those that would hear this invitation would respond to the Lord. This is directly from Jesus Christ, God's Son, saying, come. Find rest for your spiritual nature. The world is burdened with sin, heavy laden, and all the affairs of life just puts us down to where we started at the end of our rope sometimes. When that happens, we should come to the Lord. Doesn't matter what our need is, what burden we might be carrying. Jesus says, come. So, we're going to have a song and open the altars up today. Maybe someone would like to come to the altar and find peace and rest.